The Peer Advantage, episode 5005. Today we continue a chapter-by-chapter audio summary of a book by Leon Shapiro and Leo Battari entitled The Power of Peers. Today it's Chapter 3. Find the show notes over the website, growgreat.com. Just type in the search bar 5005. It'll take you to the show notes for today's episode. Chapter 3 is entitled The Path to Peer Advantage, and this chapter is it's far deeper than the first two that we have gone through so far. So there's going to be a lot to get to. I want you to listen carefully, and I want you to make some applications so that your business and your life, so that they can benefit. As always, the show is brought to you by Bula Network, LLC. Bula Network is a peer advantage company serving small business owners. If you want to find more information, go to the peeradvantage.com. My name is Randy Cantrell. Welcome. Welcome inside the Yellow Studio here in Dallas, Fort Worth, Texas. Glad that you're here. I hope you'll subscribe to the podcast. I hope you'll leave us a review over at iTunes as well. Again, the chapter is entitled The Path to Peer Advantage. We participate in four basic models or methods, I should say, of peer engagement: connect, network, optimize, and accelerate. Mostly, we do this simultaneously in a variety of ways. Connecting and networking, these are mostly individual pursuits, don't have a lot of structure. But accelerating and optimizing, those are group efforts. And the authors of this book call it peer advantage. And it makes things, well, it makes those two things, connecting, networking as individual, but it makes accelerating and optimizing more strategic and more structured. We use Facebook and LinkedIn, among other platforms, to connect and to network. And when we do, we exchange information, we extend our reach by introducing ourselves to more people, we contribute to the conversation if we choose to, we share a common interest, at least during some particular moment in time. And we rely on a high volume of people that we really don't know, peers. And we share with others in this open, unsecure area that lacks privacy and safety. And we participate if we want to. We participate when we want to. Think LinkedIn. Think Facebook. That's what we do. Dean Acosta is an Emmy Award-winning former journalist and a press secretary for NASA, and he has led corporate communication teams at some Fortune 500 companies as well. Today, he's the global head of corporate communications and media for Phillips 66, and he connects in a variety of ways that really speak to the way I think most of us connect, and he does it for a variety of different reasons. He admits that he doesn't buy anything online without first checking reviews. Well, you probably do the same thing. I know I do. From Yelp to Amazon to OpenTable, he and his wife, they rely on reviews to make their choices. But he uses Facebook. He uses Facebook to stay connected to his fellow Seton Hall University alums. He uses the Waze app. Well, here in Dallas-Fort Worth, if you don't use the Waze app, you're out of your mind. He uses the Waze app to help him navigate traffic. These social connections, they serve him every day. Well, me too. You too. He's also a member of a professional organization like the Arthur W. Page Society. That's a professional association for senior PR and corporate communication executives. And he's a member of a group called Page Up, where he can participate in a weekly online gathering, questions, answers, that sort of stuff. In fact, he has leveraged that group for his work there at Phillips 66. And he's just like you. He's just like me. He's like many of us. He has a lot of connections across a wide range of areas of his life, professionally and personally. Connecting, staying connected, it's never been easier. Networking is about purposeful relationships. When we network, we value the power of the personal relationship because we want to achieve some individual goal. And when we network, we're seeking out our peers to help us get a job, recruit clients, create business partnerships, yada, yada, yada. So when people network, we tend to not only exchange information, but now we're working with others to create opportunities. And so we select peers based on specific qualifying criteria. When we network, we're also recommending peers to other people based on trust. We work with peers toward achieving a singular goal. By networking, we understand that there's a higher degree of expected reciprocity. And we enjoy a moderately safer environment than we have when we just connect. So we can be a little bit more vulnerable, maybe not a whole lot. And we also realize that participation, it's optional when we're networking. I mean, you can connect with people on LinkedIn. More often than not, people will reach out to connect with me on LinkedIn and they'll say nothing. They just hit that blue connect button or whatever color it is these days. I rarely do that. I usually will insert some note. Now, you don't have to do that. And when people respond positively and connect with me, rarely do they type anything in. They usually just hit accept. So that's kind of how this works. You don't have to participate, and you can participate to whatever degree you want to. Now, networking gets trivialized because people tend to associate it with schmoozing at some live event. And we've all seen that guy who hits the door, right? And he's got a handful of brochures in one hand and a handful of business cards in the other, and he's working it. And we tend to think, well, that's networking. Not really. Jimmy Fallon, he credits networking for his rise from being a struggling stand-up comic to becoming a star on Saturday Night Live and eventually the host of The Tonight Show. Well, first, he benefited because his agent in Hollywood had great contacts, and that led to a couple of auditions for Saturday Night Live. In fact, the first audition didn't go very well, so he got a second one. And when he got that job, he made sure that he forged a relationship with the show's creator, Lorne Michaels. Well, now when Conan O'Brien leaves late night, Michaels, he taps Jimmy Fallon for that job. And Fallon, being smart guy that he is, he reached out to Jay Leno for some advice. And all along the way, he was earning respect because he was a good listener and he was a true student of comedy. And then in February of 2014, he was promoted to host The Tonight Show. That's how it works. Networking is about building relationships with a purpose. There is a sense of reciprocity, and that is something that you earn. And it requires us to be selfless in our pursuit of our own self-interest. Truth is, we need each other. And when we put other people ahead of ourselves by helping them, they are more likely to help us in return. This is so pervasive that there are many organizations worldwide dedicated to helping people build their personal networks. Now, it's a renewed purpose here, right here, behind Bula Network. Bula Network, to help small to medium business-sized business owners with greater connectivity so that together we can leverage joint relationships for improving our businesses and our lives. It's the whole point of the peer advantage. Well, there are a variety of organizations across the globe serving leaders and executives. Young Presidents Organization, commonly known as YPO, is one of the more prominent ones. In fact, just a few weeks ago, we had Scott Mordell. Scott is the CEO of YPO. We had him on Leo's podcast, Year of the Peer. I'm going to put a link in the show notes to that episode Otherwise, you can go over to Leo's website, leobottary.com, and just look for the episode with Scott Mordell. It was a terrific conversation. You'll benefit. Social media today, it gives all of us instant, immediate, and convenient connections. It's less time consuming unless you hop down that rabbit hole and stay there. It's less expensive. It gives us a great complement to live events. LinkedIn CEO Jeff Weiner understands the power of networking. His vision is that all 3 billion of the world's workers, they'll have a LinkedIn profile, and every company, including nonprofits, they'll have one too. Fact is, he wants a digital representation of every available job worldwide. Part-time, full-time, doesn't matter. Paid, volunteer, doesn't matter. For professionals, that's the place. LinkedIn is the place to go for networking. Not only can you have a profile, but you can also share what you care about. And you can find other people who care about the same things. It started out really kind of as a profile thing, but it has morphed into more of a social platform where now we can share some things about what we care about and about who we are. Optimizing growth is the point. Watch the Blue Angels perform, and most of us are just, we're speechless. We're left breathless at the precision and the excellence. They achieve that excellence year in and year out with different pilots because of a process they call the debrief. It's a prime example of optimizing. After every flight, it doesn't matter if it's a performance or a practice flight, the pilots will get together for a debrief session. And in that session, they will review every aspect of the flight, down to the smallest detail. They take turns talking about the errors each of them may have made. And they also make a firm commitment to the team that those errors, they'll be fixed next time. The debrief requires an acknowledgement and a commitment among peers to get better with every single flight. What happens in those meetings stays in those meetings. Pat Houlihan says it best. It's not about who is right. It's about what is right. The Blue Angels, they start the season practicing by flying 45 feet apart. By the end of the season, flying in performances, not practices, they're 18 inches apart. Those early debriefs, they can last 4 hours each time. Now, eventually, they'll dwindle down to a couple of hours. And by the time the pilots are flying just 18 inches apart, guess how long the debriefs are? 15 minutes. Optimizing is about chasing perfection in the pursuit of excellence. And that can happen in business, too. It's not just for precision flying. You optimize when you work together in teams to bring excellence to a goal. And here's what happens when we optimize. We work as part of a committed group to achieve a collective goal. We work in small groups or teams. We engage in an environment that is moderately safe so we can share exactly what's on our mind. We buy into the structure of the group as well as the collective goal of the group. And we realize that participation, it's not optional. It's essential. People who work together to optimize don't just participate in the learning process. They drive the overall standard of excellence because they help each other become better. That's how we accelerate growth. Industry-specific groups can be very valuable, and we've all participated in them. And we typically join those because we assume that we're going to learn more and we're going to get the best advice from people who already understand all the little nuances of our industry. But there's a problem. A common practice in one industry might be completely foreign to another. Stepping outside of our industry into another industry can offer us a perspective to help us achieve something new. There's a reason why you look at certain industries And everybody's doing pretty much the same thing, right? We're all reading each other's mail. Step outside your industry, things look different. People who accelerate tend to be very particular about surrounding themselves with people who share their passion and determination to achieve a goal. They tend to understand the importance of engaging with peers who have points of view and experiences unlike their own. They're committed to helping others because that's how they help themselves. When people are committed to accelerate, they also appreciate the unexpected positive outcomes that are realized in deep discussions, not just shallow mamby-pamby kind of conversation. They also value a safe, confidential space where they can share their aspirations and their fears. And plus, they accept that participation, it's mandatory. It's mandatory. And the members are going to hold each other accountable for what they do inside and outside the group meetings. Well, ladies and gentlemen, you have just heard an ideal definition of the peer advantage by Bula Network. It's about accelerating your growth as a business owner so your business grows and so does your life. I want you to visit thepeeradvantage.com to find out more. You'll be glad you did. All right, back to the book. There's big value in putting an owner of a manufacturing business in the same environment as the owner of a professional services firm, the owner of a digital agency, the owner of a custom home builder. I mean, by broadening that definition of the word peer, there is a diversity that brings high value. And you and I both know that growth is about being uncomfortable. Me, I go to the gym every day. Now, some days I take it easy. Well, I'm not 20 anymore, so wisdom prevails, you know, when you get older. But some days I know that I have to push myself or I'm not going to benefit. Growth and improvement are going to demand some degree of uncomfortableness, and they're also going to be associated with the next day probably being a little bit sore, right? It's how growth and improvement happen. Why does peer advantage work? When peers engage in cycles of learning, sharing, applying, and achieving, there's growth, individually and collectively. And here's why groups that optimize and accelerate are so effective. Here's those four things that the book lists. Learning, it's the first stage of the process. Now, sadly, for too many businesses, it's last. Learning. Learning is about demonstrating the capacity to produce quality results repeatedly. Peer groups foster application of deep learning through collaboration. I often, as I'm having conversations with CEOs and business leaders and business owners, will talk about replicating success and talk about predictable success. That's what true learning is. The book, they make a distinction between a kid jumping on a bike and being able to ride it one time versus being skilled at riding the bike every single time. Number two, sharing. Peers engage in rich dialogue, and they also ask hard questions and challenge each other to tackle complex issues. Peers reinforce and give each other permission to new ways of working. Number three, applying. Peer groups hold individuals accountable for practicing their craft and fine-tuning new ways of working. And so this peer-to-peer accountability, it's essential to the success of application of what's been and is being learned. If you learn it and you don't do anything with it, what's the point? And fourthly, achieving. Good behaviors replace bad behaviors. Achieving inspires believing, and believing fuels the hunger, well, to learn and to grow and to keep on going. It feeds on itself. It's about walking the talk. Now, the book earlier had listed, and in prior episodes, I talked about the five factors for peer advantage, and each of these five factors is going to get their own chapter as we get into chapter four, but here they are in quick review. Number one, select the right peers. That involves surrounding yourself with the right people. There's no point for Bula Network and the peer advantage to put business owners in a room with people who aren't business owners. You've got to be surrounded by the right people. So I'm purposefully going to put small to medium sized business owners in rooms together. Number two, create a safe environment. Deep conversations can best happen when you're surrounded by people that aren't going to judge you, but people that are going to listen and listen to understand. Number three, utilize a smart guide. Every group needs a leader, somebody who's expert at facilitating the group's discussions. Hello, my hands are in the air. That's who I am. Number four, foster valuable interaction. Deep conversations don't just happen by accident. There has to be a design to go deeper. And number five, be accountable. Being a member of a group that optimizes and accelerates well is to be part of a group where members don't tell you what you should do. No, instead, you tell them what you plan to do. Group accountability gives peer advantage its punctuation. Now, this chapter concludes by pointing out that generally people connect more than they network, and they network more than they optimize or accelerate. And that's absolutely true. And the book also ends, this chapter ends, by admonishing CEOs and business owners whose time is extremely valuable to invest their energy in these peer engagement activities in just the opposite order that most of us do it. And that is, business owners and CEOs should accelerate first and then optimize and then network and then connect. And their logic is very pointed and it's very clear. Invest your time where you get the biggest value. Ask any high achieving, high performing business owner or CEO in a group, and they'll tell you peers will broaden and deepen your knowledge while helping you lead your company more effectively. And there it was. Chapter 3 of the book by Leon Shapiro and Leo Battari entitled The Power of Peers: How the Company You Keep Drives Leadership, Growth, and Success. And I would encourage you to buy the book if you haven't already. Follow along with us in the podcast. And the next time, we're going to dive into chapter 4, and it's going to begin part two, the five factors for peer advantage, those five factors that we just ended with. Each of those is going to get its own chapter, and we'll be going through those, Lord willing, the next time. Again, visit thepeeradvantage.com for details about what is happening here at Bula Network. We're forming two groups, an AM group and a PM group. Two groups of seven small to medium business owners, size business owners in each group. So 14 business owners total. It's going to be highly profitable, highly valuable, and has a pretty terrific ROI. Find out more details by going to thepeeradvantage.com. I'm glad you're here. I hope you'll subscribe to the podcast. Again, leave us a review over at iTunes if you've not done that. I haven't solicited those, so why not? Thanks again for being here. My name's Randy Cantrell, coming to you from live and recorded inside the Yellow Studio.